2.3, graphs that enlighten and graphs that deceive. We're also going to include scatter plots from 2.4. The key concept is to introduce other common graphs that foster understanding of data. Discuss some graphs that are deceptive because they create impressions about data that are somehow misleading or wrong. Technology now provides us with powerful tools for generating a wide variety of graphs. The first graph that we'll study is a dot plot. Dot plots are graphs of quantitative data in which each data value is plotted as a point or dot above a horizontal scale of values. Dots representing equal values are stacked. Notice that the horizontal scale begins at 40, ends at 110, and counts by 10 in order to fit the data. We also have a label showing that this data is pulse rates of males. The features of a dot plot: displays the shape of distribution of data. It is usually possible to recreate the original list of data values. Let's draw a dot plot for pulse rates. Listed below are pulse rates, beats per minute, of females. Construct a dot plot to represent the data. Is there a pulse rate that appears to be an outlier? If we look at the data set, we notice that 36 is the smallest data value and 95 is the largest data value. When we draw our horizontal scale, include our scale, we need to make sure we can capture all the data values. So if we start at 35 and count by fives, we'll need to make sure we get up to 95 to include the largest data value. 60, 65, 70, 75, 80, 85, 90, and 95. And then I place a dot for each one of the data points. So here's 80, and then 95, 58, here I'm going to have to, 58 would be about right here, 55, 66, 82, 78, 86, 89, 57, 36, 66. Oop, that was another one, wasn't it? So if we've got two of the same data values, we want to stack them. Uh, 66, 78. And did we have another 78? Yes, we did, so we'll stack it. 61 and 65. The more data points you have, I think the clearer the shape of the distribution of the data. Here we're asked to determine if there appears to be an outlier. Well, an outlier is a data value or a couple of data values that lie well outside of the cluster of the other data values. It looks like maybe this is an outlier because it lies far away from the rest of the data. Stem plots, or stem and leaf plots, represents quantitative data by separating each value into two parts. The stem, such as the leftmost digit, and the leaf, such as the rightmost digit. So in this first row, the pulse rates of 40 and 42 are represented with a 4 and the vertical slash and 0, 2. Typically, the leaves are arranged in numerical order. And another example would be this row would be 90, 92, 94, 96, 96. So you keep all of the data values in there from their original set. If you think about how this distribution would look if I were to turn it on its side and draw that normal curve, or a curve, maybe not normal. Let's see what it looks like. If I were to draw this curve, now you got to picture this laying on its side. It almost has a bell-shaped distribution, so this data seems to be normal. The features of a stem plot is it's a quick way to manually sort data, shows the shape of the distribution of the data, you retain the original data values, and the sample data are sorted, arranged in order. Let's construct a stem plot for these test scores. And then we want to determine if the shape appears to be normal. So a stem plot, remember that stem and leaves. So we need the stems and the leaves with these numbers. The stem would be the, well, actually we'll start with the leaves. These are the ones digits, and then the stem would be the tens or tens and hundreds, as the case may be. The lowest data, oh, these are in order, which is great. Usually it's not in order, and stem plots are good for putting data values in order. So we've got our first stem is a 6, the leaf is a 7. Get rid of this stray marking here. And then we have a 7 with a 3. Oh, I see that maybe we don't have complete order. An 8 with a 5. Another 7, don't put any commas in between the numbers. They just simply list an order from left to right in the leaves. And then 2 89s and an 88. So an 88 and 2 89s, a 90, a 99, and a 100. Does the shape appear to be a normal distribution? If we were to draw that normal curve shape, or the shape of the distribution, I don't know, I keep saying that, but I can see that it appears to be a normal distribution. So that is yes, it does have the shape of a normal distribution. Time series graphs are line graphs. They're dots that represent each of the counts within a particular category, and the dots are connected in order from left to right. So a graph of time series data, which are quantitative data that have been collected at different points in time, such as monthly or yearly. Now just make note that we are using a consistent scale on the horizontal axis. It's the year labeled and counted by in blocks of 5 years. And the law enforcement fatalities is a count that starts at 100, so there really should be a little break in the graph. And then counting by 20s for the vertical scale. The feature of a time series graph is it reveals information about trends over time. A bar graph is a graph of bars of equal width to show frequencies of categories or of categorical or qualitative data. The bars may or may not be separated by small gaps. The feature of a bar graph is it shows the relative distribution of categorical data so that it's easier to compare the different categories. A Pareto chart is a bar graph for categorical data with the added stipulation that the bars are arranged in descending order according to frequency, so the bars decrease in height from left to right. The features of a Pareto chart shows the relative distribution of categorical data so that it's easier to compare the different categories, draws attention to the most important ones. Here's an example of a Pareto chart of stolen boats. This is the type of boat, the category across the bottom, so this is categorical data, and then the number of stolen boats in the vertical axis. So let's construct a Pareto chart for retractions in biomedical journals. In a study of retractions in biomedical journals, 425 were due to error, 212 were due to plagiarism, 863 were due to fraud, 325 were due to duplications of publications, and 246 had other causes. Construct a Pareto chart. Among such retractions, does misconduct, the fraud, duplication, or plagiarism appear to be a major factor? So to construct the Pareto chart, we draw the x and y axes. Actually, it may be good to organize the data first by looking at the categories and the frequency. So I'm going to put categories. The first category was error, and the number of retractions was 425. The next one was plagiarism, and the counts were 212. Fraud had a count of 863. Duplication of publications was 325, and 246 had other causes. Remember, with a Pareto chart, we need the highest frequency on the left, and it decreases to the lowest frequency on the right. So we need to put our fraud bar first, and the count for that, if we look at a vertical scale, looks like 200 may be a good starting point. And again, because we're not starting at zero, we want to show a little break. Now, as you've noticed, that's not necessarily consistent. This would be 200. And then maybe count by 4 or 200 since I've got to get up to 863. And then I draw the bars. So fraud comes first. It's the largest bar at 863. So I'm going to draw the bar for fraud. And the next bar height would be error. So I'm going to draw a bar for error at 425. And the bars typically don't join. They're not adjacent like in a histogram in a bar chart. And then the next one is duplication. So duplication's at 325. So I'm going to have a 325. And then other would be 246. So that's 246. 212 for plagiarism. Oops, a little bit too tall. It's close to the height of the other one, but not as tall. And that's a Pareto chart. Now, among such retractions, does misconduct, such as fraud, duplication, plagiarism, appear to be a major factor? Well, I would say yes, since fraud is the most frequently occurring reason that retractions are made in biomedical journals. And if you add duplication and plagiarism into the mix, then that certainly exceeds half or more. It's a lot of the data points when you add them together. So I would say yes, it's appears to be a major factor. Pie charts are a very common graph that depicts categorical data as slices of a circle, in which the size of each slice is proportional to the frequency count for the category. The feature of a pie graph is it shows the distribution of categorical data in a commonly used format. Here's an example showing the pie chart for stolen boats. And notice that the most frequently stolen boat is a jet ski, and then motorboats. Frequency polygons is a graph using line segments connected to points located directly above class midpoint values. A frequency polygon is very similar to a histogram, but a frequency polygon uses line segments instead of bars. A variation of the basic frequency polygon is the relative frequency polygon, which uses relative frequencies, proportions or percentages for the vertical scale. Here's an example of a frequency polygon, and these are class midpoints. Notice that there's line segments between the frequency dots. It's McDonald's lunchtime, lunch service time in seconds. And you'll see that the data points are connected back in the front end, last part to the axis. A relative frequency polygon is a frequency polygon with proportion represented on the vertical axis. Here we've got the McDonald's and Dunkin' Donuts depicted as frequency polygons. So it is easy to see in the pictorial representation of this graph that the Dunkin' Donuts lunch drive-through service times are much less in some cases than McDonald's service times. And the last graph is a scatter plot. Scatter plots or scatter diagrams are graphs of ordered pairs, x, y. They're quantitative data with a horizontal x-axis and a vertical y-axis. The horizontal axis is used for the first variable x and the vertical is used for the second. This is an example of a scatter plot, shoe print length and height. If you'll notice, the shoe print length in centimeters is on the horizontal axis, and the height is on the vertical axis. The paired data are plotted as points in the coordinate plane here. So it's just basically a graph of XY ordered pairs.